Hi, I'm Jack Barnes, President and CEO of People's United Bank. I'm here on Audubon Street in New Haven, a vibrant cultural center. People's United Bank is proud to support the communities where we live and work. That's why we're supporting CPTV and the many Connecticut cultural treasures they will be featuring over the coming months. Look for stories each week featuring a cultural treasure in your neighborhood.
Prudence Crandall, who opened an academy for young African-American women in the 1830s, is Connecticut's state heroine. But there's a lot about her life that people don't know. She and her students faced harassment and violence to become a pivotal fixture in the national abolitionist movement.
As we're walking up the stairs, remember that these are original.
Some Canterbury students are learning about the drama of her story.
I think especially when the museum first opened that the storyline was looked at very simplistically. She was seen as this calm, Quaker, quiet woman. It was not that at all. She was someone who came at the controversy fully well knowing what she was to face.
She was a woman who had a lot of inner strength, a lot of moral courage.
She actually fought very hard for her school and got to teach who she wanted to.
After opening the school in downtown Canterbury and completing 1 year with a roster of white students, Prudence was approached by the 19-year-old African-American Sarah Harris. Harris was a friend of Crandall's maid.
Sarah had access to the building. While here, she could hear the girls discussing, learning, having their classes.
Sarah Harris really, really wanted to teach. And to be able to teach, what do you have to do now? If you want to be a teacher, you have to do what?
Go to college and get a
right.
degree.
And this was the highest level of education that she could get.
Prudence read the Liberator paper. She knows the anti-slavery movement. She knows the injustice that African Americans are living every day. With Sarah coming to her requesting an education, she sees that as her way of providing and assisting in the cause one-on-one.
The result was drastic. The community turned against Prudence. Facing dwindling resources, growing local hostility, and an increasing amount of media attention, Prudence formulated a new plan. She reopened the school as an academy for young women of color.
Eventually, the student body includes girls coming from Boston, Providence, New Haven, New York City, as far away as Philadelphia. Now, these are African-American young women that are coming from upper-middle-class black families who, in some cases, could have provided a similar level of education within their own communities. These families were doing that because they knew it would become a court case. They knew this would eventually end up in the courts.
And it did. The state passed a law aimed specifically at Crandall, prohibiting African Americans from entering Connecticut for the purpose of getting an education. Prudence was tied up in lawsuits for months. Although the academy had supporters, they were out of state and abroad. The local community, including her neighbor Andrew Judson, continued to make life incredibly difficult for Prudence and her students.
Once the state of Connecticut passed what was called the Black Law, which in essence makes it illegal for Prudence to operate the academy, though she continues, the harassment, the violence escalates to a point where there is an attempt to set the building on fire.
Someone probably put their hand outside underneath the rocks in the foundation with some scraps of wood and some leaves and set fire to it that way.
Fortunately, the blaze never really takes, but it's this constant increasing level of harassment, violence.
Despite the daily harassment, Prudence and her students continued on with their educations and their lives. Amidst the ongoing challenges, Sarah Harris got married and became pregnant with her first child.
September 9th, Sarah Harris's baby is born in the morning. Everybody's all excited. And that night, they surround the school and they have the riot and they smash all the windows.
It makes me sad that the people of Canterbury acted this way.
Fearing for their safety, Prudence was forced to close the school permanently.
Once the academy closed, the house was sold, and then it stayed in private ownership until the state of Connecticut bought the house in 1969. We were really lucky that the state of Connecticut stepped in and bought the building. I think they may have bought it for different reasons in the 60s. It was a matter of the beginnings of Black history, looking at research, just the very beginnings of women's history. But the storyline is so much bigger than that.
It's cool that something important happened in Canterbury, where I live.
Funding for Connecticut's cultural treasures is provided by CPTV, Connecticut Tourism, the State Historic Preservation Office, Melinda and Paul Sullivan, and People's United Bank, what know-how can do.